the retirement pool, whether it's a 401k type plan, which basically is something equivalent to our provident fund equivalent, and that finds its way into asset management companies. In India, we have none of it. Now, I understand that there is a proposal to sort of open up that sector. We have to see whether that permission really comes, allowing the trustees to allocate. But if you look at the fine print of this budget, there is something very interesting in it. It allows many people, all of us who are employees or salaried, if we do not want to participate in the EPFO, we can actually choose to participate in the new pension scheme as an alternative, which actually gives you the chance to be take exposure in an equity product in your pension product.
Really? Be your own fund manager.
You can be your own. It is actually given out to other fund managers, but you can actually say, no, I don't want to be a member of the EPFO. I actually want to put my retirement pool into by contributing to the NPS, which is the national new pension scheme. That gives you an exposure for your retirement money into an equity type product as well. It's not been well covered, but that's a huge advantage.
I was not aware of that. That's good. Nilesh, I mean, we have less than 2% of the population holding a DMAT account, right? EPF pension funds aren't really investing in equities yet. The PEs of some of the companies, Hindustan Lever, Eicher Motors, are in the stratosphere. What happens if this actually happens? If the retail money starts coming in, if pension fund money starts coming in, if institutional money starts coming in, what's going to happen to the Indian equity markets?
And then the sky will be limit. We have seen when retail investors comes crazily into the market, 91, 2000 kind of scenarios will happen. But now there are two parts to retail investors. One, there is a smart money, which is investing in equity mutual funds via systematic investment plan. And we are running at an all-time high level of SIP contribution into equity funds. My guess is that we'll probably touch 25 to 30,000 crore this year in SIP. This is smart money. I presume it will be patient money. The second one is the, you know, let's say immature money. They have FD to FNO approach. So either their car is in reverse gear in fixed deposits where they don't make any real return, or they just accelerate to the fifth gear and straight away go into FNO. Sometimes they are lucky, but most of the time they are unlucky. So we will see ups and downs of the markets, but now I think the word of mouth is spreading among investors.
Yes.
You find people who are 5 year, 10 year, 15 year, 20 year investor into mutual funds. And now, you know, let me ask one question to audience. Do you believe Warren Buffett is the god of investment? I mean, all of us will agree. We have grown worshipping him as a god. He is Sachin Tendulkar for us. But if Warren Buffett was a fund manager in Indian mutual fund industry, my guess is that he would have lost his job.
Because he underperformed S&P for the last 5 years?
No. I don't want to, you know, go against my God. So I have taken his 15-year performance, and he has outperformed S&P in US dollar terms by about 2 or 3%. And in my universe of mutual funds, and I'm excluding some of the, you know, mutual funds, so that's a caveat. But in my universe of mutual fund, the worst performing equity fund manager has delivered better return in US dollar terms than Warren Buffett.
But over a shorter period.
15 years is not a short period of time.
But I actually think if you look at his career, I'm not sure, but if you look at his career, he's outperformed S&P by a huge margin.
Agreed.
S&P is up 9% maybe compounded, while he's up 21%.
Agreed. But like, you know, that someone mentioned that give me a place to stand and put a volley and I lift the earth. Give me 30 years time frame and then world will talk that, okay, Mr. XYZ or Mr. PQR was also Warren Buffett of India.
Oh, there will definitely be Warren Buffetts of India. I have no doubt about that. We already know the names, you know, people.
And Warren Buffett never managed subscriptions which were going in and out every day. He had a patient pool of money. He never faced redemptions. I mean, we are essentially a warrior which on one side is tackling market and on the other side is tackling investors, daily in and out of money.
Okay, let's move on from the budgets to my favorite topic, which is bull markets. Nilesh, you mentioned earlier that you got in 91, 92. Great bull market. 2000 technology bull market and many bull markets after that. But each one is a story. The 92 bull market saw India as a liberalized country. 2000 bull market saw India come as a technology superpower. What is this bull market telling you?
So this bull market is combination of couple of things. One, globally India today looks far, far superior to other countries. In China, you are pumping credit to create growth. Their credit to GDP ratio is almost twice that of India. And that also on numbers which one can't rely upon. Russia, oil price collapse has killed their economy. And their political actions are also restricting investors to go over there. Brazil, partly down with commodity collapses, partly down with their populist policies. So today in the world, when you see, India appears bright. So one, we expect Gora flows to continue into the country. The second is the domestic flows. The under ownership of equity is striking. I mean, either Indians would like to remain poor or they'll become smart enough to invest in equity. And my guess is there are more smarter Indians than before. So flows wise, you have great demand. From a supply point of view, now market has become wiser. In this bull run, you haven't seen a company changing his name from XYZ to XYZ Telecom Limited or XYZ Technology Limited.
It will happen. Almost assuredly. Assuredly.
My feeling is that
human nature doesn't change.
Human nature doesn't change, but my feeling is that this time at least fund managers have become wiser based on their mistakes in 2000 and 1991. So will we go wrong on valuation in quality companies? Yes, you mentioned about some of those names. But will we go wrong in picking up a company whose balance sheet is fraudulent, whose business model is fraudulent? My guess is that 99% we won't go.
You're more optimistic than I am on that matter, but I'll leave that aside. But caption this bull market. Is this the technology bull market? Is this the, you know, liberalization bull market? What is this bull market? I want a headline.
This is the bull market of India. It's a rising tide and every sector, every company will grow. But in some sense, if I have to caption, the moderately priced portfolio of stocks across various sectors will do far better than what is today expensive or today cheap. Cheap is cheap for a reason, and the expensive one probably
too
will
expensive.
Have to wait for earnings to catch up.
But the moderate side seems good.
Moderate is the place.
Milind, your take on this. What is this bull market telling us?
Ramesh, we keep analyzing and we keep burning the midnight oil to look at what all these economic triggers are. I would simply say that this bull market, to answer your question, is the bull market of the new government.
The Modi
everything
bull
changed on the sentiment, just the response. And let me speak because that's what we do all the time. People stop asking us about whether we should be buying into equity or debt after 15th of May 2014. Now they only want to know whether we should buy a large cap or a mid cap or it should be this theme or that theme. What we were talking about, the long-term merits about investing in equity, remained the same. It remained the same even earlier. But people are now responding to the fact that there is real hope, because let's not try to beat around the bush. The key event that is creating the environment for this market is the change on 15th of May 2014. Make no mistake about that. Whether some numbers were getting better, the current account deficit was getting better even a little before that, oil may have been getting a little before that, we were beyond the tapering impact. But the real change happened. And the reason is very simple. The average man invests in equity, or his view on the market depends on what he reads on the front page of the newspaper and not the business page. You can floor him with data and statistics that we all as a fraternity enjoy talking about. You connect very little with that with the population unless he sees it on the front page of the newspaper or what he thinks likely the government in the center is going to do. So, you know, we sometimes over-theorize things. We tend to look into things which, and the more we theorize and the more complex we make, we get disconnected with the man on the street. And we are in this fraternity who are selling fund products to, you know, retail market. And the more complicated we make it difficult for him to understand. And I think the language that of communication that we think is resonating now is really the language of the change of the new government. If they seem to be a group of people who will deliver, that's what people are believing in, and that's what will make the change.
Let me take a show of hands. How many of you believe that this is the Narendra Modi bull market going on?
You saw that.
Hands up.
See, what they are saying is, today's market is Manmohan Singh EPS and Narendra Modi PE ratio. The bull market will be Narendra Modi EPS and Narendra Modi PE ratio.
Okay. What you are suggesting, a subtext, is that it's not Dalal Street that matters, but perhaps what's going on in Main Street and perhaps even Mint Street. You think cutting down interest rates is an important part of this bull market?
Yeah, even Main Street matters with a lag. Main Street matters a little bit in a sense, because actually Main Street matters from the way people react to deposit rate change. You know, they're not concerned. When you look at a depositor, you have to look at a saver. End of the day, we come back to what you heard before. The real guy with the surplus is the household. When deposit rates come down, 55% of household savings are going into deposit. His first natural reaction is, let me lock into the deposit rate before the rates come down. So his initial reaction is actually of misinterpreting what a fall in interest rate is. He actually thinks it's bad for him, because he does not understand that it is going to reduce the cost of leverage to the government, cost of leverage to the corporate, so on and so forth. So I think the issue about Mint Street is important. It's important. I believe I'm in the camp that believes that savers have to be rewarded adequately. So you cannot bring rates on deposits down in a manner that they cannot deal with inflation. I'm a believer of inflation targeting, because inflation impacts the common man. Corporates can deal with higher interest rates in some way. The common man, which is what this is all about, cannot handle high inflation. And therefore, having real rates positive for reasonable periods of time or meaningfully higher real rates is important at the end of the day. Because investments will happen, but we still are an economy which is driven by consumption. And that's where we need the household and his money to be deployed sort of productively.
Great.
Interest with Ramesh, can I add a few things?
Of course, you are an expert in that.
One, India spends 49% of its net tax revenue by way of payment of interest. And our central debt to GDP ratio is just about 45%. There's no other country in the world whose interest as a percentage of government's revenue is higher than government debt as a percentage of GDP. If Japan was paying similar interest rate like India, 200% of their government's taxation revenue will go towards payment of interest, then there will be no Japan left. For a country like India, whose expenditure side of budget is so committed, 49% to interest and balance 50% to subsidies, salaries and defense, where is the money left for making any investment? And this ratio has gone from 35% to 49% in just last 5-6 years. We need a government, and which is what the NDA government had done between 1998 to 2004. We had Asian crisis in 1997. The 10-year yield was 14% plus on government securities. Then we had Pokhran bomb blast and nuclear sanctions. Then we had Kargil war with Pakistan. Then we had 9/11. Then we had Russian debt crisis, which freezed all the emerging market debt. And despite all this, the interest rate steadily kept on coming down from 14% all the way down to 7% on its way to 5%. And today, despite that dramatic fall, we are still at 49% of the revenue to interest ratio. If the interest rates were 14%, I mean, trust me, there will be no government left in the country. So we need lower interest rates. Second, the RBI came out with inflation index bond about 2 years back. And they were linked to WPI inflation. They were issued at par. Today, they are trading at 20% discount to face value. They are available at 80 rupees. Now, it clearly shows that inflation has dropped and how much our interest rates have dropped. 50 basis point vis-a-vis 20% drop in the face value of a bond. Clearly, there is something not appropriate. Third, you look at FIIs. I mean, we are BBB minus country, just a stage above investment grade. And we are getting money from FII, where all our limits are full in government securities, and almost getting chalked in corporate bond. And they're investing money at a spread which is more comparable to AA minus country. So why are FIIs putting money into India at a spread which is representative of AA minus country rather than BBB minus country? Certainly they must be feeling our rates are high. Put all these things together, we need lower interest rates. I'm not disarguing with Milind that we need to give real interest rate to the investors. We need to give them. But at the same time, we need lower interest rates for our government to provide enough money for other opportunities.
Okay. Let me move you to another area. Fairy tales end with a happy ending, as both of you know. But bull markets never have happy endings, right? Has there been any perpetual bull market or has any bull market that didn't end badly? And if you, well, first answer the question. Okay.
So thank you for giving me this opportunity because I was waiting to tell a story and I just didn't find the right opportunity.
Okay.
So let's assume that I am running a restaurant and all of you are my clients. You come to visit my restaurants. Now economy goes into turbulence and you stop visiting my restaurant. My business goes down. So I make an offer to you since all of you are my valued customers and today you are going through a tough time. But no problem, you can visit my restaurants. And you can pay whenever you are able to pay. So now instead of once a week, you are visiting 7 days a week to my restaurant. My business goes 7 times up. My customers are happy, I am happy. My suppliers are happy because I am taking 7 times more purchases. My banker is happy because he has given me 7 times more credit. His business has also gone up, his bonus has also gone up. Now there is a trader who comes and says that look on your balance sheet, these debtors are becoming a little bit higher and it is from people who will pay whenever they are able to pay. So let me securitize it. So he goes to rating agencies, gets AAA rated rating and sells it to Japanese investors. So we have a perfectly happy scenario where customers are happy, I am happy, my supplier is happy, my banker is happy, my rating agency is happy. And my investors are happy. That's the happy ending. This is how the world is going on. So if the global markets can continue to grow in this scenario for a happy ending, I think why are we worried about our bull market?
No, will it be a happy ending? Are you telling me, are you making a forecast? You're saying negative interest rates in Germany, Sweden, Denmark will have a happy ending?
But on a serious note, I really don't know how these things will unwind. Yesterday, we had a meeting with Mr. Vikram Pandit where we raised this question to him and he is far more, you know, knowledgeable than us. And he also said that, look, this is something which we have not experienced. There is no anecdote in the past which can forecast what the future will be. Probably central bankers today are trying to survive a patient who is in ICU and if he is not taken care by giving steroids, probably will have not a happy ending. So let me give the steroids and make him live for another day. The side effect of steroids, we'll see at that point of time.
Kick the can down the road.
Precise.
Milind, your thoughts on this? I mean, it's actually above most people's pay scale, but does it gnaw at you at night sometimes? You know, negative interest rates and still there's no growth coming, deflation coming. Can India actually be an oasis or are we sometimes going to be swept away in this global tsunami?
You know, the more I think, we are such natural beneficiaries about most things that seem to affect the world negatively. I mean, commodity prices are coming down, we seem to benefit. Oil, and we are in this, currently at least, clearly we are in this kind of space where almost everything seems to be going good for us. So there is no real sort of reasonable haven anywhere in the world where there is a structural growth happening. You may debate about old series, new series, what that number is. There is a global chase for growth. And we are a country which nobody, if you're a global allocator of capital, you just cannot afford to miss. So I simply believe, I don't know about bull markets and endings, but we are in for a structurally long period of high growth, which will continue to attract the kind of capital that we have never seen before. And the interesting thing, and which is beginning to happen in the last 12 months, and for the sake of our businesses and for the sake of our retail investors, we expect that continues in the going forward, is the interest among domestic investors. And we tend to look at domestic investors not just as, because we have a business in it, But the domestic money is long only money. The mutual fund money quality is people who are investing 3, 5, 7 years. When you look at FI participation, we are breaking it up into long only, the long short guys, the hedgies and so on and so forth. So the quality of flows that are looking to chase the India growth story looks structurally strong to remain for a fairly sustained period of time. What we need, and that's where we are now, is this period of transition from undeniably strong macros to translate into strong micros from corporate earnings. And as Nilesh said in a way earlier, how long are we going to wait for that macro improvement to see sort of visible in corporate earnings? Is it 4 quarters or 6 quarters? And we may argue about that, what that correct sort of whether it's 2 years or 3 years. But as an equity investor, it's not for me to get the quarters right, because I'm a long-term investor.